Please welcome your host for the evening, Gaurav Kapoor.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Yes, indeed, it was me with a different voice who did the announcement backstage. It's a charity show. We all have to pitch in. Good evening, everyone. How are you? Everyone good? Not enough juice in, I can feel. Maybe a little more. Let's check again. Hello, everybody. How are you? That's more like it. Well, good evening and welcome. Thank you so much for taking out the time and being here. Thank you for all the affection, all the love, all the support, and all the money that all of you have given. All of that has made some great things possible, and we, of course, will be telling you as the evening goes along what those great things are. But before we start, I want to say one thing. I mean, I know it's evening, but there's a sunrise quote which was brought to my attention a little while ago, which I definitely want to share with you right now. It says, "Each sunrise is an invitation for us to arise and brighten someone's day." And who would know that better than the gems and jewelry community, right? Because you spread this bright light every day in so many different ways, as we'll find out today. Well, I'm your host for the evening. I'm Gaurav Kapoor, and it's an absolute pleasure to be here to present the second edition of Jewelers for Hope, a great example of worthy causes deserving a worthy, wonderful evening. So before we begin, I think for this fantastic initiative, Jewelers for Hope, let's have a big, warm round of applause, because it's possible because of a lot of you. And of course, the Gem and Jewelry Export Promotion Council, which started their journey in 1966 and has positively impacted, well, socially, the industry as well, of course, you know, thrust to exports. Last year, exports were to the tune of $40 billion. That's B, billion, 40 billion. That's right. You can clap. You can clap for that. And of course, the council represents over 6,000 exporters. So it really is the apex body in that regard. But it's not just about the business of business. It's also about the business of goodness. That's right. A significant impact to be made socially, to share the good fortune around with people who need it a lot more, people who need equality, people who need equal chances, and the council comes together every year and unites and makes sure that that is also done. Well, last year with the Make-A-Wish Foundation, when you raised 1 crore, and so many young lives were touched, so many smiles were distributed, so much happiness was given to lives which were unfortunately just dealt a very short hand. Well, right now, let's just have a look at this quick AV, see the fantastic work that's been done in social goodness, in spreading the joy with corporate social responsibility by the council. Let's have a look at this.
Welcome to India, a land of opportunities, a land of color stones, diamonds, and gold. A proud nation which caters to the world when it comes to jewelry. But there is something more of which we are more proud of. It is the story of our industry. The gem and jewelry industry has always been proud of being responsible towards society. The Indian gem and jewelry industry represents individuals whose philanthropic activities inspire our society and bring the real essence of life. In GJEPC's endeavor to put together all concerted efforts, Gem and Jewelry National Relief Foundation, GJNRF, was set up in the year 1999. Year on year, GJNRF is working towards providing relief to victims of calamity, war, and terror in every possible way, thereby serving society and making a huge difference in their lives with new commitments and promises. GJNRF was initiated to provide assistance to defense personnel and their families in the aftermath of the Kargil War. Towards that, Diamond Ava Hostel at Kalina, Mumbai, with a capacity of 100 students, is rated very highly in the army circles. Further, a corpus was created at the defense headquarters in New Delhi for awarding merit-based scholarships to the children of defense forces personnel. After the unfortunate cyclone which hit and devastated major parts of Odisha, the industry constructed an orphanage. As part of the rehabilitation process for villages, 30,000 acres of flooded land belonging to 30,000 families was put into cultivation. The lives of many were reinstated by providing agricultural tools, tractors, water pumps, etc. The gem and jewelry industry has put in heart and soul for the relief and rehabilitation of the victims of the earthquake which adversely affected the people of Gujarat by collecting an impressive amount of 54 crore rupees from across the world. A humongous task of reconstructing three villages was undertaken, with 600 odd houses in each village. Including facilities such as electricity, drainage systems, fresh water collection and distribution, along with medical center and medical relief for cattle, small schools and shopping arcades. This was not all. Three state-of-the-art hospitals, in addition to three schools, were built for the benefit of the residents. The spirited commitment of this industry continued when floods hit Mumbai, Surat and Bihar by supplying relief items. About 6 years ago, when the global recession hit the diamond industry all over Gujarat, the sector supported school fees of around 35,000 children. GJEPC, the apex body of the Indian gem and jewelry trade, initiated the maiden edition of Jewelers for Hope in the year 2014. Year One fulfilled the wishes of children suffering from life-threatening diseases by donating the proceeds raised to Make a Wish Foundation. In our journey of serving, we received overwhelming support from overseas, significantly from Mr. Nicholas Oppenheimer, then Chairman, De Beers, and Gary Ralph, then Chairman, Rio Tinto.
Today the most important people are the students, and after the students come the teachers, because they will imbibe the students with knowledge. And in the rebuilding process, a school has been constructed which is bigger and better equipped than what went before.
On the domestic front, Mr. Mahesh Bhai Bansali inspired the entire community by personally overseeing the relief operations during the Odisha cyclone, and he also played an instrumental role in rehabilitating Nuttan Chitrod village. Mr. Nanu Bhai Vanani's contribution in changing the social landscape of Gujarat has been immense, particularly in the Amran project, where he has put in his heart and soul. Mr. Praveen Shankar Pandya and Mr. Ketan Parikh have been the pillars of these noble causes from 1999 till date. As we pledge to continue our commitment to working towards the welfare of our society, each of the welfare projects undertaken by the gem and jewelry trade will strive for the upliftment of the needy, ensuring their progress. The journey goes on. as we continue to serve society by making a difference in their lives each year with renewed commitments and promises. In the last 5 decades, this industry has strived to become leaders in the world market and has constantly improved the standards of industry by not only achieving business goals, but by also taking its social commitments to the next level, which would only grow in the years to come. We invite our industry fraternity to come forward and accelerate the various social initiatives undertaken.
A lot of good work done, but a lot more to be done. And to tell us more about that, I'd like to call upon the chairman of the council, and we welcome him on stage with a warm round of applause, Mr. Praveen Shankar Pandya. Praveen bhai, with a warm round of applause, please.
My most honorable guest from the two Swadesh and Friends of Tribal Society, Subhash Janji, Ronnie, and my guest from overseas, Mr. Bruce Cleaver, CEO of De Beers, Mr. Manoj Dwivedi. And I have Martin Rappaport, Alex Papaw. I cannot name everybody, but my friends from overseas and my fraternity from gem and jewelry industry here in Mumbai and across India, who have gathered here for IIJS, India International Jewelry Show, which is the fourth largest show in the world, with about 31,000 visitors, over 2,000 visitors from overseas, about 2,000 stalls, and one of the finest exhibition in this part of the world. Today, here in the evening, we have gathered for a different cause, and that is Jewelers for Hope. And I can tell you that this industry, if I start giving examples, there are thousands of examples of people who have been very compassionate and who have donated very generously. At the slightest event, you know, the whole industry gets together to do things, to give help, to extend help to the whole society, and that is the nature of this industry. Many times we are remembered for wrong reasons, for having very lavish weddings and things like that. But I can tell you, that's more in the papers, but if you really see the dementors, they're very, very, their donations and their charities, their contributions are par excellence. You see, I was last week at Vigyan Bhavan, where Honorable Prime Minister himself said that the way the Surat was 30 years ago, and I remember in 1970 when I used to go to America to sell diamonds, said, you cut diamonds in India, do you know how to cut them? And they would say that, you know, you have sweatshops in Surat and things like that. And the same people are today praising our Surat like never before. You know, we have such modern factories and such, you know, the whole city landscape has changed. The roads, the infrastructure. And I can tell you, people sitting here, hundreds of them have done excellent charities there. They have opened hundreds of schools. They're just in the process of building one of the largest hospitals in Gujarat. And they have done enormous things like, you know, keeping cows and various other things. So they have been doing their bit without telling anybody. You know, the world doesn't know about it. But that is how they did it. And that is why in 1999 I said that this industry must have a charitable face. And that is when we decided to start this Gem and Jewelry National Relief Foundation, which did excellent work in most of the calamities thereafter. And one of the most satisfying things for me was not just building these very swanky housing colonies in Gujarat and things like that, but really cultivating those 30,000 acres of land belonging to 30,000 families in Orissa. You know, we entered just when everybody was walking out. And there was no hope for these people because they had lost everything in Orissa. And I said, what's happening? Because all these food and everything was disappeared. They had no tools, they had no animals, nothing. How would they survive? And everybody had lost 2-3 people in their family. So how they will survive? So Mahesh Bhai Bhansali, who is incidentally here, and the local RSS team suggested that why don't we, you know, they are farmers, so let us do farming for them. So we, 1 acre for each family, we did these 30,000 acres. And God was great that within 3 months, each acre gave 10 quintals of rice. And during this period, we set up their houses, we gave them enough food, we bought them utensils, and we did everything for them. So this way, 30,000 families went back into farming. I think that was the most satisfying thing for me. Apart from that, I have people sitting here who, you know, we are just giving a small appreciation to our two major NGOs. It's not a lot. I can tell you here, people sitting in audience give 5 times more to the same NGOs themselves in their single capacity. But it is honoring their effort. That is exactly what I'm trying to do. Our industry has grown to become the leader in the world markets with an staggering 2,50,000 crores of exports. And I can tell you still there is a lot there because we are still not there in the jewelry exports. We are still fourth in the world markets while China still has a leading position of 1,20,000 crores against our 45,000 crores. But we need to, the way we have improved a lot of diamond workers and the diamond community, the same way we have to improve a lot of the jewelers community. We still have those sweatshops around Johri Bazaar and other places, which, you know, like IT park, we need to have a jewelry park. And that is what we have been striving to bring into this country. When we were selecting for our CSR contribution, Zarina had come there with her team. And I was thinking that what kind of Swadesh they are running. But, you know, she floored me in 5 minutes. The way, the passionate she was about her cause. And the one thing that struck me most, what Ronnie told Zarina, that, you know, we must undertake. When they sold their UTV, got a lot of money, they put in a lot of money for charity. And the one thing he said, that I want to do something different. And then Ronnie told her that let's improve the life of 1 million people. I mean, that's a huge thing to think and then act upon. And that is what I thought that one was the most important thing they did. And I wish them all the well. I think that we need 3,000 more people like Ronnie to change the face of India. This industry has grown because In the earlier days, De Beers, whose CEO is sitting here, Bruce Cleaver, they literally helped India grow this business. You know, they did the hand-holding to us when we were actually buying rough diamonds from Antwerp and other places. They came here, they helped us set up our factories, they helped us become more transparent in business. And that is why, and whenever we needed, they helped us. During our earthquake, they donated the amount for one school, completely $1 million. So they have been constantly with the Indian industry. And I must thank them for their continued support to our cause and to our industry. I must also speak about Friends of Tribal Society, which probably you will see that how they have been, excellent job they have been doing. They're running 59,000 schools in the tribal belt of India. And you see, education is one thing that, you know, we must give to our children. And that is the way to enlighten them, to take them to the next level. And that is exactly what these spirited, my sisters and my brothers have been doing for last 20 years. And I must say that they have great enthusiasm. And I again fully support them, I congratulate them, and I wish them well. And I think they soon will be able to reach their goal of 100,000 schools. And I appeal to my all diamond and jewelry friends that you have to, you know, listen to our Prime Minister, who has advised us to take the whole industry to the next level. And going to the next level is not just transparency of business, but, you know, our ethical practices, our social responsibilities, and all other things that are associated with it. With these words, I thank you. I thank you all.
Sir, can I request you to just come back on stage for one second? There's one more bit of business that I'd like to take care of, or like you to take care of. I know a very important moment, a very important landmark is coming up, which is the 50-year celebration. So would you like to tell us about that? Would you like to throw some light on it? There you go.
Yes. Actually, you caught me. I was to speak on 50th year, but you know, I got carried away by these two NGOs, so I forgot my own business. But I must say that, you know, the council, Gem and Jewelry Export Promotion Council, has completed a journey of 50 years this year, and we are going to be celebrating this for in the month of January, where Honorable Prime Minister has promised to come. And we are having a international diamond seminars and a lot of things in those 4 days. And I must say that this journey has been, we were nowhere in the picture. Like if you see, it's like a Kargil Hills. Today we are occupying most of the peaks. But those days we were down there with 35 crores of export in 1966 in diamonds. Today we have 1,35,000 crores. Similarly, in these 50 years, tremendous journeys have been done. And I salute to all my fraternity who have made it possible, not only those who are sitting here, but also their fathers and other people who, in those controlled regimes, when it was impossible to get diamonds into this country for cutting and polishing, how they have managed to start this industry. So I salute them.
Can we also call Vice Chairman on stage, please, to just unveil the logo for 50 years? It's yours to do now. You have to take over because Chairman was saying that I need my partner in crime to come on stage and unveil the logo. So if you could just speak a little about it, speak about the 50 years, just a few lines, and then we'll show everybody the special logo.
Well, first of all, thank you everybody for coming here. I'm pretty young in council, you know, this is kind of my first year. So I'm discovering what Gems and Jewelry Council is and what is the good work they are doing. And which is fantastic. I'm happy to be associated with it and give Pranveen Bhai whatever support I can. And let's see, you know, we are still young, long way to go, and hopefully we'll do much better moving forward. Thank you.
Fantastic. Can we have a look at the logo, please? A lot of celebrations and special things coming up with that as well. But today, let's move forward on our show. Well, to move forward, and we're talking about 50 years, we're now going to talk to somebody who himself, is not older than that, but represents a company which is far older than that, is synonymous with diamonds. When you think diamonds, world over, you think De Beers. So let's have a look at all the fantastic work they've been doing before we invite Mr. Cleaver on stage.
Our story begins where light began. Light touches everything we do. As we explore, as we discover, as we inspire, since 1888. Symbol of commitment. As our story ends, theirs begins, and our pursuit of brilliance goes on.
Have the privilege to call on stage a man who is so accomplished in the industry. He's on the boards of Debswana, De Beers Consolidated Mines, Namdeb Holdings, and De Beers Diamond Jewelers. A man who's been consistently growing in stature, recognition, and respect not just in his own company, but also all over the industry. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the CEO of De Beers Group, Mr. Bruce Cleaver.
Good evening, everybody. Thank you all for joining us here tonight as we celebrate the great work that is being undertaken in India to support opportunities for those elsewhere in society who desperately need our help. Tonight's event is very close to my own heart, as the whole of the De Beers Group of Companies places responsibility and sustainability at the center of its business strategy. Our group is committed to ensuring that diamonds are transformed into economic wealth and lasting improvements in the quality of life and well-being of everybody touched by its businesses. In 2015 alone, De Beers invested over $28 million in social projects, with direct benefits to over 47,000 people in the local communities in which we operate. De Beers continually strives to improve our own standards, and we remain pioneers in offering free and confidential HIV/AIDS testing, wellness, and antiretroviral treatment to 100% of our global workforce. As a result, we have seen significantly lower rates of HIV/AIDS infection in our workforce when compared to national averages in Southern Africa. We call this building forever. But of course, delivering on this objective requires a reliable strategy for sustainable development, as well as commitment to adhering to that strategy. I have talked a lot about partnerships and collaboration since I recently began my tenure as CEO of the De Beers Group. And once again, I believe this to be of great importance in defining a successful strategy for sustainability and responsibility. As such, much of what we achieve in this field is delivered through collaborative initiatives, and we also see our partners sharing our ethos and undertaking their own highly effective initiatives, helping to amplify the great work that is done by the broader diamond industry. Forevermark is one of the important ways in which we work with industry partners to ensure a responsible and sustainable approach to business. Forevermark diamonds are marketed on the basis that they are beautiful, rare, and responsibly sourced. Each Forevermark diamond therefore embodies our values of integrity, opportunity, and environmental stewardship. Forevermark and its partners share in the De Beers Group's common principles of partnership, development and accountability. And all of us involved in the program have a sense of shared responsibility for its social, environmental, and economic impacts. In the pursuit of integrity, we keep careful track of Forevermark diamonds throughout the cutting and polishing process. This guarantees that they are conflict-free, untreated, and completely natural. In addition, every Forevermark diamond comes from a mine that has met our exacting sustainability standards. But of course, the focus on responsible business permeates the industry much more widely, and I pay tribute to the outstanding work that is being done by a range of siteholder businesses to support their local communities in a number of very important areas. The spirit of giving back to society seems inherent in the siteholder and diamond community, and I am always humbled to see the impact of these programs on the people who depend so heavily for their support. De Beers siteholders are involved in various outstanding initiatives in healthcare, such as setting up hospitals and conducting important medical research to help overcome some of the key health challenges facing Indian communities. Education is another key area, with siteholders having set up institutions to provide both primary and specialized education. This is a natural extension of what De Beers tries to achieve, and I am deeply proud of what Indian sightholder businesses are doing to create a lasting and positive change through these extraordinary social programs. But tonight we are here to recognize, celebrate, and support one particularly impressive and impactful industry. In India, Forevermark has partnered with the Swadesh Foundation and continues to support the organization with its range of hugely important initiatives in the country. Founded by Ronnie and Zarina, the Swadesh Foundation operates with the single-minded focus of empowering rural India. Their vision is rural empowerment through best practices, modern technology, and values. The foundation rightly believes that sustainable change in rural India should be built from the ground up, starting by transforming the lives of people in India's villages and creating new opportunities through effective partnership with corporate backers, the Indian government, and young urban Indians. We believe this initiative has amazing transformative power as it aims to use pre-existing standards of best practice and corporate thinking to develop truly sustainable strategies. It is a thinking foundation with ambitious long-term goals that will create lasting change instead of just short-term impacts. It has a wide focus on a range of key issues, including community, agriculture, water, healthcare, education, and livelihood. So it offers a truly holistic response to the current challenges faced in rural India. By aiming to empower 1 million rural Indians every 5 years, the Swadesh Foundation genuinely has the power to transform India and unlock the huge potential that resides here as more and more people can access greater social and economic opportunity. So thank you for joining us here with GJEPC to support Swadesh. This is a truly noble cause and fits perfectly with our focus at De Beers. At De Beers, we call this building forever, as we believe diamonds have the power to catalyze immutable and enduring positive change in the world. But such change is only possible if good people and good businesses continue to support it. Fortunately, the Indian diamond community is full of such individuals and companies, so initiatives such as these are empowered to go from strength to strength. So, ladies and gentlemen, please raise your glasses tonight to Swadesh and all the tremendous work they do. By supporting their efforts, we are making rural empowerment real and ensuring that here in India, while diamonds do good, the people of rural India can do even better. Thank you.
Mr. Cleaver, could I request you to be on stage for just one moment? And I'd like to request Mrs. Mona Mehta to please come up on stage and present you with a small token of our appreciation and thanks for being here. Well, so Praveen Bhai has spoken and Mr. Cleaver has spoken, of course, about the great work being done by the Swadesh Foundation. Hi, Dia, how are you? It's okay, I can say hi to her in front of everyone else. But of course, it's so difficult to encapsulate the work, the fantastic work that they've been doing because, you know, I've heard about it, I've read about it, but you still, I don't think, can get an idea of the positive impact they're making besides the numbers that we've spoken about right now. But let's try. We shall. 1 million lives to be touched. 1 million lives to be changed. They have a workforce of 1,600 people. That's right, 1,600 people, out of which 1,300 are volunteers. Is that correct? Most of these people are on the ground. Most of these people are working directly with those 1 million people. And the great work is being done in community mobilization, in education, nutrition, what have you, everything that is required. So in our attempt to just show you the great work that they're doing, besides just talking about it, we're going to show you this little film. Let's have a look. The first time I saw that, it left me a little misty-eyed, and even now when I've seen it for the third time, it still sends a little happy chill down my spine, because that's the good work that you're doing. Ladies and gentlemen, let's get them on stage, please. Let's hear from them. Please welcome the forces behind the Swadesh Foundation, Zarina and Ronnie Screwvala, with a big round of applause, please. I'd also like to request Manisha Sanghani and Mr. Shailesh Sanghani to please come up on stage for a little floral tribute, a little token of appreciation. If you could do the honors, please. Mic 20, please.
Hello, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you so very much for today. It's a very special day for us. Praveen Bhai, thank you. That was a lovely speech. Russell, I don't know where you're sitting. Huh? Thank you very, very much. Mr. Cleaver, thank you for your very kind words. Senik, who I've not actually met, but thank you very much. And of course, Sachin Jain, thanks to you. Thanks to Biren, who introduced us. So I really, really like the name for today's evening, Jewelers of Hope. I think it's beautiful. You know, when we first started thinking about this dream of ours and how we were going to make it happen, we actually asked ourselves, what is poverty? And the answer we came up with after almost 6 months of debating and talking to people is that poverty is really an absence of hope. It is the absence of the ability to dream of a better life for yourself and the people you love. And that, for me personally and for Ronnie, is the most heartbreaking thing about poverty, that people lack the ability to hope and to dream. And so this has committed itself and made a promise that we will lift 1 million people out of poverty every 5 years. But, I mean, okay, so we did this promise to ourselves in, I think it was May 2012. We did 1 year of research and study where we traveled the length and the breadth of the country, met amazing people, really amazing people, studied. We went to Bangladesh, met BRAC. I don't know if you've heard of them, Sir Faisal. For the first time in my life, I was really starstruck. I mean, I have the most amazing Dia Mirza here. And I mean, but to be honest, I've never asked a film star for a photograph with them. But when I met Sir Faisal, I said, Sir, can I please have a photograph with you? Because that man has single-handedly, along with another gentleman whom you've heard of, Grameen Bank, transformed the indices of a whole nation. And from that visit came a huge inspiration to both Ronnie and me that really it can be done. People can be lifted out of poverty permanently. But I think being maybe a little foolish, maybe a little stupid, and many people did call us crazy, I remember this, 4 years ago. Today they tell us it's the only way to do it. We told them that we talked about it to a lot of our friends, and we decided to create a model of development with a 360 degree approach, which means there is no silver bullet to removing poverty. There is no one thing. If you say, I'll do this one thing, I'll build this one toilet, or this water, or this education, or this nutrition, or this health, or this livelihood, or this agriculture, this one thing that will remove people from poverty, it won't happen. It won't happen. If you examine your own lives and that of your children, what would you give up? Would you give up their education? Would you give up health? A livelihood for yourselves? Water in your homes? Toilet in your home? You wouldn't give up anything. So we decided to create a very unique model, which is the 360 degree model of development. We call it the inside out model of development. And we embarked on this journey 3 years ago, made from very, very small beginnings, where our community was only 39,000 people. Today, I'm very happy to tell you that it is just under 5 lakh people. We work in 2,000 villages. Thank you. 360 GPs. And as Gaurav said, we have 1,600 people, of which 1,300 are community volunteers. I don't know if you can see this lady over here in the white coat and the other one in the white coat. So we have 1,000 of them. We have another about almost 500 agricultural volunteers, and we have 350 full-time professionals, three of which are with us today. I'm very happy that they managed to come. The rest are all in the field. 90% of those 350, almost everybody, works at the grassroots level. The other thing we believe very deeply in is a collaborative approach. We work very deeply with the government. We work with 30 partners and execute over 70 different programs. And most important of all, the real partnership that we have is with our community. And what we're really working to do in the end, if you look at it, is rural empowerment. That's what we believe in. And we have a motto that says, Swa se bane desh, swadesh. Bruce, for that. That means that Swa is the I, but not the lower I, the higher I, the soul, if you like. Swa, it's a higher self. Se bane des, which means I make my country. I bring the change. I think we've heard that many, many times, and we also hope to do that. And today, with great gratitude, we're happy to receive what you're about to give us. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you.
Could Ronnie and Zarina please take a seat, and then we can just have a little chat. Yes, we will, in just a moment.
So I just want to say a few words, actually.
And, yes.
I think Zaina said most of it, but I again want to thank everyone for here. Praveen Bhai, thank you very much for your very kind words. Russell, for having us. De Beers, thank you for everything and your contribution. I know you're celebrating your 50th anniversary, but I remember a little over 36 years ago, when I was much, much younger, my first tryst came with the Gem and Jewelry Export Promotion Council, because I was invited to host a fashion show with, at that time, all the beautiful ladies. And it was my first overseas trip ever to Singapore. I'd never traveled abroad. And suddenly I was invited by Jeannie Navroji, who at that time was choreographing for the Gem and Jewelry Export Promotion Council. And it was a thrilling experience. So to come back and see the logo evolve since the last 36 years, it brings me back with a lot of nostalgic memories. And the last thing maybe I'd like to just share, and Zaina has spoken a lot about Swadesh, and I think everyone is here. We all discuss philanthropy in a very broad sense, and sometimes it does frustrate me that there is a perception that there isn't so much of it going around in India, and there's always a question mark as to why aren't we doing more. And I can tell you, in the 6 to 9 months that we did and met people across India, there is an incredible amount of sweat equity and an incredible amount of people doing some great work. And if the United States contributes 2% of their GDP, and we are guilty of only contributing 0.2% of our GDP, I don't think we need to look down on that. Because if you add the sweat equity, we cross that 2% of GDP. And I think most of the developing nations, when they do that, it's mostly for educational institutions and many others. Many of them, personally, from my point of view, may not even need some of those grants that actually go to them. So I think we need to be a very proud nation to the fact that there is a fair amount of incredible work that goes on here. And the last I would like to urge everyone here is that in India, as compared to in most other places, the challenge here is not about cutting a check. I think it needs manpower and the brain capital that this room represents and many of us represent. And I think it needs as much of your time. And even if you give 10% of your time and 0.01% of your wealth, it'll make an incredible difference. Because the challenges for India to solve the problems are very unique. And I don't think today we have the mature enough foundations and NGOs at that scale to be able to take it there. And we need the brain power of corporate India to actually contribute in an intelligent manner, because there are lots of problems to be solved, and unless we're on the ground, we don't know how to solve them. And I think that's just my sort of appeal to everyone, that that's the next level of some sense of participation of sweat equity outside of their financial contribution. But again, thank you, Gem and Jewelry and Export Promotion Council, for having us here and for this generous donation. Thank you.
It's really interesting that 36 years ago, they were the first ones to take you out of the country, and today they're giving you something to keep you in country for longer, right? Just to work even deeper in the country. But to both of you, the question that I ask is, and there's something so interesting that you said, that when you were starting out, you know, the quote I thought of, or the line that I thought of, is first they laugh at you, then they call you crazy, and then they follow you. Have you noticed that happening? Have you noticed in the last few years that the ones who thought that this dream was absolutely ludicrous are now on board and behind you?
Well, I think the main thing was how we wanted to do it. I think what really everyone laughed at us a lot and really did call us crazy, actually, are now saying this is the only way to do it, which is the 360-degree model. And I think that is actually, honestly, it's really hard. It's really tough. And it's a struggle. Almost every single day we have huge problems. But the main thing is we try and solve them, we overcome them, in partnership with our community, in partnership with the government, and we have 30 fabulous partners and we have an amazing team. So yeah, I do agree.
When was
I just want to add to that. Zainab didn't mention one thing. You see, we come from media and entertainment where most of the days everyone thinks we're mad and crazy.
Yeah.
So we're quite used to that thought process where everyone's questioning, why are you doing what you're doing half the time?
And I think also to add to Rani's point is we're also really used to failing. I think in media, you fail spectacularly. When you take out a movie or a big TV show that the next day is an utter dud, the whole world knows about it, and the whole world is like waggling their fingers at you and saying, see, I told you this is not going to work. So we're used to it, and we're okay with it. We don't mind if we fail.
Trust me, I know about that. I've read a few of my own reviews which made me want to hide. But Rani, I mean, it's so interesting you say about entertainment and media, and we're all about emotion, about stirring emotion. Is there, and I know there'd be so many, but the first moment or some moment that happened which made you believe that you were on the right path, something that you saw, a child, an old person, anything that comes to mind?
You know, that's nice and storytelling-wise, anecdotally important, but it doesn't work that way. Life is not about that. But I think what happened to us was not really when we looked at scaling this up, but I would say 20 years back when we started our company, and I think we'd sort of decided that 10% of whatever we were doing, we would put aside, and that was very small beginnings. And I remember at our board meeting, one of our investors had just come in and he said, well, this is all good, but what about the years in which you're not going to make a profit? What are you going to do at that stage? And we said, we're entrepreneurs, we'll figure that out. So I think that the base was really the philosophy. I think it comes into the culture. It builds organizations and in culture. And I think the 20 years of that took us to the last 3.5 years of what we're doing today.
But if you want a story...
Oh, yeah, I should have asked you for the story, right? Not
story.
Just the practical.
So that lady in the white coat, I'm going to tell you a story of one of them. They're called Swaraksha Mitras. The one I'm going to tell you about is not on the wall. I think it's outside, though. Her name is Vidya Kule. About 6 years ago, we asked her to come and join one of our self-help groups. She joined one of the self-help groups. 3 years ago, she became a Swaraksha Mitra. And today, not today, because she just had to resign after a little while, but she became the sarpanch of her village after becoming a widow. Sorry, I missed my whole point of my story is, her timeline is as follows. She became a part of our self-help group. She became a Swaraksha Mitra, which is meaning that she goes from door to door and actually saves lives. In the middle of this whole thing, she became a widow. And then she was elected sarpanch of her village. So that's a story for you.
And there must be so many more like this, right? There must be so many more. Let's also call, now I think we should
yes,
call
please.
Dia on stage, yeah? Ladies and gentlemen, you have known her as an actress and a beauty queen, but I don't call her a beauty queen, I call her a power princess because she's harnessing all her power for social good now. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the wonderful Dia Mirza.
I have to tell you something. No, Dia, you tell them. Okay, I'll tell you. So, Dia just told me that her very first assignment, one of her earliest assignments when she was 17 years old, was for De Beers. So, there
wow.
you go.
Wow.
Yeah.
That was like 5 years ago, right? Six.
I love you, Gaurav.
We're old friends. I mean, while doing social good, Dia, more than Dia, actually, Dia's cook has done a lot of social good for me as well. We've been neighbors for a long time, and when I was young and kitchenless in Mumbai, her cook used to make lovely dosas for us. So I think this started a long time ago. I think that was your first emotion of seeing social good happening.
That was my first experience in social good.
And from there on, you decided to save tigers and, of course, do a lot more things.
Yes.
But you, of course, are an avid supporter, an ardent supporter of the efforts of the Swadesh Foundation. So tell us about how you've seen Rani and Zarina sort of passionately get involved in this over the last few years.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you so much for having me. Thank you, Swadesh, for yet again allowing me to come here and cheer for you, because I feel a great sense of pride every time I get the opportunity to. Growing up, there's always a sense of participation. One would like to feel, I mean, your school encourages you and then your college does. At home, I was encouraged, and I always felt a great sense of happiness every time I came back after doing something that I knew was making a difference in somebody's life. And I would often wonder, when does that stop? And then you grow older and you realize it stops when you become busy with yourself and expanding your own life ambitions and going on to doing the very many things that you want to do, the goals you want to achieve. And somewhere along that process of that participation and that fantastic feeling that one gets in participating with more people than just yourself starts disappearing. And it's very interesting how, despite great successes, there is a kind of an emptiness that looms. It just kind of takes over. And I think what Ronnie and Zarina are examples of are individuals who grew as individuals first and then as an organization, but they never lost sight of that very important aspect of being and being contented individuals, you know, and remembering that the only way they can be truly happy is if they're making a difference. And I know that that has more to do with Zarina than it does with Ronnie.
No.
Oops.
No. Okay, she will, of course. You're all heart, Zarina. And I know that without him, your heart would not beat. But, and you agree with me, right, Ronnie? Yeah. So, anyway, let's go back to the story. And when they first called me and told me about what they were doing with Swadesh, I was just blown away. I was so amazed at their intention. And I also knew somewhere within my heart that it was an intention that they would make possible. Because they just are those kind of people. They make everything that they set out to do happen. And it's been a remarkable three and a half years of watching them grow from strength to strength, making great strides, making such a huge social impact. And I work a lot with corporates. I'm on the board of some organizations, and I know how difficult it is for NGOs in the country to convince corporations to invest in them. And a lot of corporates have agendas. So a lot of the CSR donations that are made, or the money spent through CSR, is always, everybody has like their own thing. We will do health, and we will do education, or we will do XYZ, but nobody really says, I'm going to support somebody who's doing everything. So I know what a big challenge it must be for them to convince people to say, hey, you know what, I'm going to back an effort that wants to take care of everything. And but there has been a great growth in attitudes of people, wonderful, wonderful changes. I think when CSR was first introduced, it was done sometimes grudgingly and sometimes because, you know, people were getting a tax benefit. But it's amazing to see how wonderfully corporations have started reveling in the good work that they're doing. They're taking a great sense of pride in their participation. They're really, really proud about their accomplishments, because, you know, when you reach out and you make a difference and you start seeing results, it really puts a sense of goodness in you. And I think it's also transforming the way companies operate in India and the way people, individuals, are even approaching their own lives. So it's wonderful times in India. There's a lot of work to be done, and I'm just so happy I'm sitting in a room full of people who are doing that work. And thank you, Zarina and Ronnie, for inspiring change, because, you know, it's a wonderful thing to hear great stories, but it's another thing to see people in action, see people doing the work. And I think the only legacy that all of us are always looking for is a great story, right, to leave behind. And I think that those stories are changing every day. They're becoming more about we and less about I.
Fantastic. And you are leaving a million stories behind and a million stories every 5 years. And that's something I think that should inspire and motivate everybody. And Ronnie, like you rightfully said, it's not just about giving money. It's also about giving time. It's sweat equity and being there. Dia.
One thing I quickly want to add,
sure.
Because they both spoke about their volunteer group, and that's something that I find is so remarkable, because there are people from cities, urban centers, and of course rural centers, who are part of Swadesh because they want to give, they want to share their skills. You know, they're actually out there on the ground doing work because they believe that sharing their skills is going to impact change, and that's a huge thing. They could be busy in the city making money, doing other things, but they choose to be out there in rural India, creating sustainable solutions and sharing their skill sets, which is fantastic.
Truly collaborative at every level. Well, let's...
Gaurav, can I say one thing?
Yeah, sure, of course.
I want to really point out and commend one gentleman who's in this room. I just recently met your brother, sir. I haven't met you. Mahesh Bansali ji. I don't know where you're sitting. But I met your brother Ashok just 2 weeks ago. And the work you do, sir, I mean, you deserve every success. And we were so impressed. It is truly, truly magnificent. To your whole family, really wish you. We were really blown away. Congratulations.
Well, I'd like to invite on stage, Praveen Bhai, if we could have you back on stage, please. Mr. Bruce Cleaver. And of course, Mr. Shaunak Parekh, the convener, National Exhibition of the Council. Could I request you to please come up on stage? Ladies and gentlemen, a check of 50 lakhs for the Swadesh Foundation for the great work. A small drop in their large ocean, but we're grateful nonetheless. Thank you so much. Let's have a big round of applause, please, for Zarina, Ronnie, and Dia. Praveen Bhai, can I request you to please stay on stage for just a moment? Praveen Bhai, if I could just request you to stay on stage. You know, today Zarina just spoke about, and we're going to, of course, also speak about the efforts of Mr. Mahesh Bansali, who's been contributing remarkably through the Bansali Trust. It's one of the largest trusts that have been set up by the Diamond Industry, by an individual for natural disasters to post-war efforts. The trust has been doing remarkable work for almost 5 decades. Please give them a big round of applause. It truly has been a fantastic effort. And I'd also like to call up on stage Mr. Mahesh Bhai Bansali. Could we please welcome him on stage with a warm round of applause, actually with a resounding round of applause. First, I'd request you to say a few words.
Mahesh Bhai is one of the few examples. I don't know how Zarina knows about him, but in our industry, Bansali Trust, which was initially started by Dinesh Bhai Bansali, he was one of the person in our industry who in those days, when the industry was growing, did tremendous work. He went, when there was a drought, he would collect thousands of cows to actually tell you the exact number, 80,000 cows from different villages around Saurashtra, put a number on each cow and keep them for 2 years, 3 years, feed them with different donations and also work, and then actually return after 2 years or 3 years to their actual owners. This is how we started, but then a lot of other things they have done. And Mahesh Bhai, who is engineer by education, left everything. He did not marry, and he has been carrying on the work of all these charities ever since. In Gaya, they have been doing eyes operation. How many transplants have you done so far? 7 lakh eye operations they have done so far in last 25. One of the largest ever done by any personnel. And this trust has been called by the government of Bihar, the government of Gujarat. Always when any kind of calamity comes, he has been always consulted. We also took his this thing, and when we did this 30,000 acres of land tilting, he took his 50 people, he went to Orissa, he took a house, he settled all those 50 volunteers there, and he went about doing his work in a very normal way for 3 months. And he finished his job and he came back. Similarly, Nutan Chitrod village, where we had this 600 houses, it was such a difficult case for us. He did all the social engineering, finished the work and came back. So like that, he has been continuously doing this work. He's also looking after his diamond business. His whole family is like that. So it's an honor for me to honor him. Thank you.
आदरणीय प्रवीण भाई डायमंड बाजार से आए हुए सभी महानुभाव मुझे पता नहीं था कि मुझे आज अवार्ड देने वाले हैं प्रवीण भाई ने मुझे इसे बोला कि आपको आना है इसलिए ये अवार्ड मुझे मिला है मैं इनके लिए जेमिन ज्वेलरी काउंसिल का बहुत बहुत आभारी हूँ और पूरा डायमंड ट्रेड का भी आभारी हूँ लेकिन मैंने लाइफ की एक एम है प्रतिज्ञा है कि मैं कभी कोई अवार्ड लेता नहीं हूँ मैं जो काम करता हूँ मेरे आनंद के लिए करता हूँ इसलिए अवार्ड मैं विथ थैंक्स डायमंड ट्रेड को अर्पित करता हूँ और दूसरी बात आज तक जितना काम हुए है इसमें पूरा डायमंड ट्रेड ने सपोर्ट किया है अकाल के टाइम पे अर्थक्वेक के टाइम पे साइक्लोन के टाइम पे और आज भी बिहार में जो हमारा कैंप चल रहा है इसमें डायमंड के 4-5 बहुत अच्छी कंपनियाँ हर साल हमको पूरा सहयोग दे रही है जिसमें महेंद्र ब्रदर्स है पी डी कोठारी कंपनी है ऐसे बहुत से लोग हैं जो हर साल इस काम में देते हैं ऐसे तो हमारा ट्रस्ट हमारी फैमिली से चलाते हम पूरा सेल्फ सफिशिएंट है लेकिन ऐसे ऐसा जो बड़े प्रोजेक्ट आते हैं उसमें पूरा डायमंड ट्रेड ने आज तक हमको सहयोग दिया है और ये डायमंड ट्रेड फ्यूचर में भी ये ऐसे कामों में करते रहेंगे यही मेरी शुभकामना है और शुभ भावना है मेरा हमारे साथ में जो सैकड़ों हजारों कार्यकर काम कर रहे हैं इनकी मेहनत से और पूरा हमारा परिवार परिवार के जो हमारे ब्रदर्स वगैरह वो सब पूरे के पूरा साथ रहते हुए ये काम होता है मैंने कुछ नहीं किया है मैं तो जो करता हूँ मेरे आनंद के लिए करता हूँ यही मेरी शुभकामना है थैंक
बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद महेश भाई ऐसे ही नानू भाई वानानी ने जो कि आज मिनिस्टर हैं गुजरात मिनिस्ट्री में उन्होंने भी हमारे जो अर्थक्वेक में आमरण विलेज का काम किया था उनको भी आज ऑनर करना था वो आज नहीं आ सके क्योंकि गुजरात की जो मुख्यमंत्री थी उनका दौरा था सूरत में इसलिए उन्होंने क्षमा याचना की है पर हम लोग उनको भी धन्यवाद देते हैं थैंक यू
Thank you so much, Praveen Bhai, for doing the honors. And thank you so much, sir, for all the great work that you've been doing. Ek bari aur, sir, zordaar taaliyan ho jaye unke liye, please.
Well, we have two NGOs that we're supporting, two great initiatives that we're supporting, and we're going to jump straight into the second one right now. Praveen Bhai has just informed me that Mr. Subhash Chandra has to leave shortly, so we're going to carry straight on. Well, we're going to take a short break, but we're going to carry straight on. We're going to talk about the Friends for Tribal Society. Now, the Friends for Tribal Society is unparalleled across the globe. Started in 1989, it runs over 53,000 schools. 53,000 schools. And has as many as 7,000 volunteers working day and night to make it possible. Come on, give them a big round of applause. 7,000 volunteers. And of course, jab imarat itni badi hoti hai, to foundation pillars bhi bahut hote hain. So amongst the foundations, the pillars of this fantastic initiative are the following dignitaries. Mr. Subhash Chandra, Mrs. Sushila Goyal, Mr. Dilip Kumar Lakhi, Mr. Jitendra Bansali, Kunj Lata Bansali, Mrs. Nayantara Jain, Mrs. Chandralekha Rungta, Mrs. Seema Goyal, Mrs. Sarita Mansinka, Mrs. Namita Pandya. Can I request a big round of applause for all of them? And of course, to tell us more about the fantastic work that FTS is doing, I'd like to request Mrs. Namita Pandya to join us on stage. And while she walks up on stage, I'd like to just tell you that she's actually part of both sides of the equation today. So she is poised to give us a fantastic perspective, sitting in a vantage point of both. So please, ladies and gentlemen, welcome with a warm round of applause, Mrs. Pandya.
It's a pleasure to share this evening for hope for better tomorrow. I will not take much of your time. I know we are getting late, so I will make as precise as possible. Time can take everything from a person, but it cannot take away one's education. Education enlightens and empowers everyone, especially society. In today's globalization, where countries' borders are losing relevance, it is important that our youth are educated to determine right from wrong, to lead a positive life. FTS is empowering the tribal belt of India by not only educating, but also by creating awareness of health, hygiene, and overall village development. Village development is important to become self-reliant so as to avoid exploitation by others. Friends, FTS achieves all this at very low administrative cost. Can you believe? Just 8%. It is a testimony of its efficiency. This is a direct result of the selfless dedication of its workers and teachers. Today, FTS is an organization that covers length and breadth of the country. Its area of operation includes some of the most sensitive areas like Dantewada, Jammu, and Kashmir. At present, we have 33 chapters in India, 53,000 schools. It is a vehicle that is informing and educating over 1.4 million students towards a better tomorrow. AKL is supported by more than 12 countries globally and more than 60% of their support. Swami Vivekanand rightly said, if child cannot go to school, school should go to the child. FTS religiously believes towards this practice it in action. One teacher's school is a brainchild of Sri Shyamji Gupta, who is a gold medalist in the field of engineering, and he dedicated his whole life to this cause. Happy to announce that our wonderful dedicated team present here today. I would like them to stand up so everybody can see them. We are working together for over two decades for betterment of India. I can proudly say that FTS is not just an organization, but it is a movement for the better tomorrow. A small visual presentation which would like to share with you, AKL stepping forward. I request to play that CV, and I request Gaurav?
Video?
Yes.